Labour are about to reintroduce a bill they first proposed in 2018 to somewhat amend the result of that vote. Senator Ivana Bacic joins us now on News Talk. Good afternoon, Ivana.
Good afternoon, Sean. Thanks for inviting me on.
To be clear about things, the amendment to the Constitution in 2004 isn't explicit about what the law is. It kind of gives that authority to the government. Is that right?
Well, in fact, Sean, as you say, it gives the authority to the Oireachtas to legislate as to how the acquisition and loss of Irish nationality and citizenship will be regulated. So the 27th Amendment to the Constitution, passed in 2004, did indeed remove an automatic right to citizenship on birth, but it replaced it with a provision, what we call an enabling provision, providing the Oireachtas, as I say, with the power to make laws on citizenship, including birthright citizenship or including any other mode of citizenship. Now, in fact, the law that subsequently passed, the legislation passed in 2004, which has been amended since, provides for fairly restrictive citizenship, really confined mostly to bloodline rather than birthright. So, in other words, somebody who's never lived in Ireland is still, of course, entitled to Irish citizenship if they have a parent or grandparent who's Irish. Mm. But we've never provided back for a sort of citizenship based on birthright. So what we're proposing with this bill, which, as you say, we first introduced in the Shannon or Senate back in 2018, is to restore a pathway to citizenship for children born in Ireland. And we want to do this, I suppose, in a spirit of generosity and solidarity. But our prompt back in 2018 was a number of cases that had come to public attention, notably a case of a young boy in Bray in Wicklow called Eric, who was 9 years old at the time, lived all his life in Ireland and born in Ireland, and his family nonetheless were threatened with deportation to China, a country where he had never been. Mm. And, you know, his classmates in fourth class in St. Cronan's National School at the time rallied around. There was a big campaign, and the government actually relented, and the deportation order was revoked and the family got humanitarian leave to remain. I suppose our concern was that we knew of a number of other cases where, again, you know, there'd been interventions, political interventions on a one-off basis, but we were conscious that there were also going to be a small number of other children whose families would be faced with the threat of deportation, but who mightn't have the wherewithal to mount a sort of campaign, and yet who would be deprived of the ability to stay on in Ireland, despite, again, having children who might have been born and lived for many years in Ireland and known no other home. So I suppose what we're seeking to do with this bill is to bring a measure of generosity and to enable children in that situation to apply for citizenship and to give them a pathway. And I have to say, we were supported in 2018 by Fianna Fáil and the Green Party in the Senate. It passed second stage in the Shannon, and we're bringing it back next week to the next stage in the Shannon. And we are really asking Fianna Fáil and Sinn Féin support. We're asking Fianna Fáil, Fine Gael and the Greens to back the bill this time, to allow it go forward. We're very much open to working with Minister McEntee and her colleagues in amending it, but we just want to see, and you know, the NGOs that are supporting us include the Migrant Rights Centre and others, we all want to see some semblance of a pathway to citizenship for those children who have been born in Ireland and have lived here for years.
Explicitly in the bill, what is that path? Is it something like a time limit if you've lived here for a certain amount of time?
Yes, we're saying that children should be entitled to citizenship if they've lived here for 3 years. Currently, they have to have lived here for 5 years, but also there's other restrictions. So, in other words, just residence isn't enough. In current law, children also need to have been resident, to have had parents here who are themselves legally resident and not resident for the purpose of study or for other more temporary purposes. So our bill would not only shorten the time of residence, but it would also enable children to apply irrespective of the legal status of the parents. So it's really trying to restore the rights of children and place those to the fore where a child has been born in Ireland, lived for a period in Ireland.
Mm. Are all the kids who were or might be in the future affected by this, are they? It is all as a result of direct provision limbo.
Well, no, and you know, we don't know for sure how many children. We think there's a relatively small number. There was a lot of scaremongering, as some of your listeners will recall, in 2004 about large numbers. In fact, the figures produced at the time were very insubstantial, and indeed, there was no attempt to analyse them. If one looks at figures of, for example, children born to non-national parents at the time, most of those non-national parents were in fact EU citizens. So clearly, in those cases, they wouldn't be applying for Irish citizenship, because they were EU citizens in any case. Mm. Certainly there will be some children, I think, in direct provision who will be affected, but it's not about direct provision directly. It's about a pathway to citizenship for children born in Ireland in all sorts of settings,
right,
where they're not entitled to apply by virtue virtue of their parents' citizenship status.
Now, well, because I suppose part of the worry why that got a lot of support in 2004, that particular referendum, was the sense that you could have your child born in Ireland and then you're automatically given residency in Ireland. Would that be the case now then? Because if you give citizenship to a child who's been born and spent many years here, but then their parents don't have the right to live here, then what do you do?
Well, our bill doesn't provide citizenship rights for the parents in that circumstance, and clearly there'd need to be an application in any case. So what we're seeking to do, I suppose, is restore the children's rights. We want to put the child front and centre in this bill. And we're conscious, I suppose, that, you know, that referendum was 16 years ago, that I think public opinion has moved on. And indeed, there's a more recent Sunday Times poll suggesting that over 70% of people in Ireland would like to see birthright citizenship restored. I think we are now approaching this in a spirit of greater generosity and solidarity. And indeed, this year, with the awful COVID pandemic, we've seen really harrowing cases of for example, frontline healthcare workers and care workers who are living here and working here for many years and who are facing uncertainty about legal status. So I think there's a general better feeling of goodwill now than perhaps there was in 2004 towards people, particularly children, whose families are facing this sort of uncertainty. But, you know, would the bill provide a pathway for the family? No, not directly. We're looking at the child rights here and the issue of birthright citizenship. After that, any family members or parents would have to apply in the normal way, as people do apply currently.
Yeah, though, might it be opening it's the thin end of the wedge, might it be opening the door to that?
Well, always we find whenever there's any attempt to, I suppose, provide for more generous approaches to citizenship, there's what we might call a sort of floodgates argument put forward. But again, there's really no basis for that and no evidence for that and no evidence was produced in 2004. As I say, there was some anecdotal stories, and then there were figures about non-nationals which didn't, in fact, give the full story, because, of course, as we know, as I say, the vast majority of people who are not Irish citizens living in Ireland are in fact EU citizens from other European states. So that really wasn't, so they wouldn't in that case be seeking Irish citizenship because they have European citizenship status. So, you know, I don't think there's any basis what we might call this floodgates argument or the slippery slope argument. And I think we do also have to just say, look, you know, people who come to Ireland have made an enormous contribution to Ireland. My own family, Sean, my grandfather came here and re-established Waterford Glass after the war, having come here seeking refuge from post-war Czechoslovak political situation, which was very, very difficult. So, you know, I think we have to look at the enormous contribution that people make in our new communities and people make when they come into Ireland. And, you know, my party, the Labour Party, stood firmly against the referendum in 2004, a very proud stance, arguing that we should be generous and that we should be providing citizenship on birthright. And I'm proud of that Labour tradition. And, you know, this bill is in keeping with that.
Though at the same time, the majority of the Irish voters at the time disagreed with you based on a pretty... Now, whether the figures were dodgy or not, I suppose, to leave that aside for a moment, but it was based on a clear understanding that what we want to prevent is people using the birth of a child here or the residency of a child here as a way for the entire family to stay in the country.
Well, as I say, that was 16 years ago. We've certainly had different referendums reversed in different years. But of course, the referendum didn't abolish birthright citizenship. It removed it from the Constitution, but it did specifically enable the Oireachtas to legislate, and it didn't put any limits on how the Oireachtas can legislate. So it's perfectly constitutional to seek to reintroduce automatic birthright citizenship or to introduce, a more nuanced or more modest proposal requiring certain period of time spent in Ireland following birth of a child here. So, you know, the Oireachtas is given the power through that amendment to legislate for citizenship. And I think as Oireachtas members, we do need to grasp the nettle on this and recognise the contribution that people make when they come here and recognise in particular that where we have two children born side by side in one of our maternity hospitals, that it's simply unfair and unjust for one child to have a clear pathway to citizenship based on their parents' legal status and the other child not. So, you know, our citizenship laws on bloodline are in fact rather generous. As I say, you don't need to have any period of residency here to apply for citizenship on bloodline. But on birthright, it's very restrictive. And, you know, we had formerly birthright citizenship, and there wasn't, until 2004, there really hadn't been any argument made about abuse. And I think in 2004, what we saw was, as I say, some rather really scaremongering tactics being used and anecdotes being plucked from the air, and no real figures, no clear figures and no clear evidence of abuse.
And so now what's the future passage of this bill? Who gets to look at it next?
Well, it'll be before the Seanad next Wednesday evening in Labour private members' time. So myself and my Labour colleagues will be bringing it forward. We have a number of amendments to it, and one of them is, one of the amendments that my colleague Senator Rebecca Moynihan has been pressing for, is to reduce the fee that people currently have to pay when they are applying for citizenship. And I know that's something that has been an issue for people. So we're going to be bringing forward some amendments. We're going to be debating that. In the meantime, between now and then, I'm certainly in discussions with Minister McEntee, with the government senators and so on, to seek to ensure that the bill might pass to the next stage. So it won't become law, even if it's passed through the next stage. There's a further stage to be had in the Seanad. And then, of course, it would also have to go through all stages in the Dáil. So there's a long road ahead. But what we would like to do is work constructively with government to try and achieve a compromise where there would be a more accessible pathway to citizenship for children born in Ireland, subject to conditions that the government may seek to impose. But, you know, again, just to give children some hope, to give their families some hope that they can regularise their status, where they've lived here for some time and where they don't know any other home but Ireland.
Before I let you go, Ivana, I must ask you about the Seamus Wolf situation. Is there a way forward on this for the government?
Well, I know that the Minister McEntee is currently, I think, answering questions in the Dáil on it. And I know that Labour leader Alan Kelly and others have been actively seeking that the Minister would come before the Dáil to answer those questions about the process of appointment. So I suppose we'll have to see what happens from today's Q&A session and see what the Minister says about that. I think the Seamus Wolf issue itself is, and Golfgate and all of that, you know, there's been a path to resolution has been achieved there, but I think the issue now has become the issue on which Minister McEntee is answering questions. So, I mean, we'll have to see what is said in the Dáil today.
Right, but as a law lecturer, as an experienced lawyer yourself, what is your view on the appointment process?
I've always argued for reform of the appointment process. I did a study some years ago on gender in the legal system where we were highly critical of appointments, not just for appointment of judges or processes for appointment of judges, but also processes for appointment of senior counsel, for appointment of senior partners and so on. We argued for transparent processes to be used. We argued for the Judicial Appointments Board to have